You are now listening to PAR,
Just People Activity Radio.
If you do not understand white supremacy, what it is and how it works, everything else that you understand will confuse you.
The hunt is on. And you're the prey.
Spoken word, performance poetry, are the humble, modest parents of rhyme culture scattered all over the experiment we all know as society. Spoken word, performance poetry dominate popular culture in its most recent form called rap, which is packaged, promoted, and distributed in the locomotive bulldozer we know as the hip-hop industry. As I understand it, there is no movement without starting point. As I understand it, there is no direction without destination. As I understand it, the soil of anti-justice is the base from which all things we know as is manifests. Toxic soil, toxic seeds, toxic libation, toxic creatures of the toxic global order. Now that's either true or it's not true.
When life seems full of clouds and rain, and I am full of nothing and pain, who soothes my thumping brain? Nobody.
On the most super basic level, Burt Williams was the first black global superstar of popular culture and performance. Years before there was a music industry, really a black music industry, Burt Williams had one of the biggest so-called record contracts that anyone had ever had. His songs and recorded songs were the most popular. He was the man who integrated Broadway. Before Burt Williams, Broadway was segregated, and when he integrated Broadway, he integrated it not as a token or as a special case. He was a bigger star than the other performers on Broadway. And so Florence Ziegfeld even said, when he was pressured to fire Burt Williams or to not allow him to join the cast, Ziegfeld said more or less, "I can fire everybody except the guy you want me to fire." He was that famous. Before he integrated Broadway, he and his partner George Walker and Ada Overton Walker, they organized, led the largest and most successful black performing organization in history at the time. The Williams and Walker shows. They performed all over the country. Burt Williams, once he became a solo act after George Walker died, performed all over the world. He performed for the King of England. He was the first black man to make more money than the U.S. president, which back then was a big deal. Now everybody makes more money than the U.S. president, but back then that was a remarkable thing. He started an organization, or was one of the co-founders of an organization called the Frogs, which was a benevolent, black benevolent and educational organization that featured members from James Reese Europe and other important black cultural figures in Harlem in before the era that we call the Harlem Renaissance in the 1920s. He was just a completely dominant cultural figure, at least through performance and art. During the late 19th and early 20th century. Burt Williams' name for it to have become tangential, as you say, or for it to have become marginal, that in itself is a story. Because he was, in fact, that big and that powerful. In fact, he was the first black performer that publicly has to negotiate all of the things that we now associate with black crossover celebrities. He was the first to do those things.
I would say that one thing that's helpful to remember is that during his time, he was described by one of the white theater critics as the greatest comedian on the American stage, not the greatest black comedian, which to me was saying that he'd reached the heights of fame and the heights of success in terms of his performance, that it wasn't qualified.
Another way he negotiates it, which is the core of the controversy around Bert Williams to this day, is that his entire celebrity, his power, his impact, his skill, was rooted in the fact that he wore blackface.
Minstrelsy, black minstrelsy, was actually white people blackening up to imitate black people, making a caricature out of them as they saw them on the plantation, not knowing that for a form of entertainment, black people were mimicking white people. White people were able to receive a career imitating blacks, and also not allowing blacks to be on stage. And then after the Civil War, there was the opportunity for blacks, some blacks, to be able to perform on stage. And they, as black people, having to blacken up to imitate white people who were blackening up to imitate black people. How crazy. How crazy. How crazy.
When life is full of clouds and rain, and I am filled with naught but pain, now who sews my thumping, bumping brain? Nobody. When winter comes with ice and sleet, and me with hunger and cold feet, now who says, well, here, here's two bits, go out and eat? Nobody. Now, I ain't never done nothing to nobody, and yet, I ain't never got nothing from nobody at no time. So until I do get something from somebody at some time, I don't intend to do nothing for nobody at no time, no sir. When I try hard and scheme and plan to look as good as e'er I can, now who says, look at that handsome pan? Nobody. And when all day long things go amiss, and I go home to find some bliss, who hands to me a big glowing kiss? Nobody. Now, I ain't never done nothing to nobody, nothing that I knows of. And yet I ain't never got nothing, that is not a whole lot of nothing, from nobody at no time. So, until I do get a whole mess of something from somebody at some time, I don't intend to do nothing for nobody at no time, no sir.
Minstrelsy, black minstrelsy, was actually white people blackening up to imitate black people, making a caricature out of them as they saw them on the plantation, not knowing that for a form of entertainment, black people were mimicking white people. White people were able to receive a career imitating blacks, and also not allowing blacks to be on stage. And then after the Civil War, there was the opportunity for blacks, some blacks, to be able to perform on stage. And they, as black people, having to blacken up to imitate white people who were blackening up to imitate black people. How crazy. How crazy.
At the same time that Red Fox was out there, this is again 60s, 70s, Bill Cosby's out there, Dick Gregory is out there, there is a woman, a black woman, and as far as I know, she was the only one operating at that level at that time. I'm of course talking about Moms Mabley. Moms Mabley.
Right. Moms Mabley is recognized as the first black female comedian, and she was taken out on the road by a team called Butterbeans and Susie. They gave her her first break.
Butterbeans and Susie. Butterbeans and Susie.
What's wrong now?
Why, you ain't nothing but a low-down loafer.
Stop that.
When I get in your car, you keep getting so bold. Believe me, butter, someday I'm gonna get you told.
Now, look here.
What is it?
Miss Switchboard Operator, I done found out that you ain't nothing but a real man hater. Why in the world don't you tend to your own phone?
What do you mean?
And let a hard-working man alone.
Then listen, Elevated Papa.
Yes.
Seem like you always want to go down.
Now look here, Switchboard Mama, you got the bummest connection in town.
Is that so?
Use one operator that's hard to get. I whacked at your receiver until I'm all upset.
Why, before you use your lever, you should close the door. With me, you always get stuck between the floors.
Now, Switchboard Mama.
What is it?
Switchboard Mama, I don't see how in the world that you getting by.
Is that so?
I put a nickel in your slop, and it rained all night.
Well, I'm not to blame, butter, if you didn't put it in right. Elevated Papa.
Look here, Switchboard Mama, your service doesn't satisfy.
Is that so?
Now, Sue, your switchboard's been out of order ever since way last spring.
Uh-huh.
Tell the truth, you ought to get somebody to fix that thing. Because every time I plug it up, your trunk line falls, and you give no satisfaction on your long-distance call. I done told you about it half a dozen times before. Your receiver's worn out, and it doesn't work anymore. Now your buzz is old and doesn't buzz like it should, and I can't use your mouthpiece, cause that ain't no good.
Well, I'm gonna tell a superintendent just what you do.
What who do?
Why, you couldn't run his elevator if he knew.
If he knew what?
Why, you waste a lot of power when I get inside.
Uh-huh.
Cause you keep going up and down each time I ride.
Is that so?
Why, you get so excited, you don't know which is which.
Uh-huh.
Instead of pulling your lever, then you throw off your switch. Why, you take me to the basement, and if I should squawk, why, you put me out and tell me, go ahead on, old broad, you got to walk.
Is that so?
Why, Elevated Papa?
Look here, Switchboard Mama.
Well, now your service doesn't satisfy, no, sir.
Why is it that we haven't had the numbers of black female comics that we had for men in terms of the success? I mean, we do have Whoopi Goldberg, obviously, Wanda Sykes is contemporary, Monique, contemporary comedians, and there are others, I'm sure, but it would seem relatively few in comparison to the numbers of men.
I can speak from this from experience because I live with a black female comedian right now, and it's tough for her and it's tough for a lot of her peers because when you are attractive, number one, it's harder to get work. It would seem easier, but it's harder because everybody, from the doorman to the promoter to other comics, they're jamming you and they're not really caring about your comedy. Whereas when you have other women, such as more portly women who go with the mammy role, it's a lot easier for them. Or if you have women that go from the Mom Mabley tradition, it's a little easier for them. Also, due to the fact that comics, by large, have to do a lot of road work. And the road is a whole different game for women than it is for men.
You know, it's nice to have nice neighbors. Nice to steal if they're your friend. Cause, honey, a friend in need is a friend indeed. All too thick and thin. Now they'll give you the shirt right off their back and feed you every time. But there's one accommodation at which they draw the line. Now if you knock on your neighbor's door and listen right away, I bet my bottom dollar you're gonna hear that neighbor say, "Hide the whiskey." Hide the whiskey. Oh, honey, if I've told you once, I've told you three or four. if you want us to drink again, don't let them people in. First, hide your whiskey. Hide that whiskey before you open that door. Now, the missionary members of the Ladies Auxiliary were having their weekly repast, and baby, they wasn't drinking no tea. When the members, one of them by the window, shouted, "Oh, my dear, I see the preacher coming, and I know he's coming right here. Hurry up, hide the whiskey. Hide the whiskey. You know he drank us up once before. Now to save his soul from sin, and to save us all a sip of that gin, hide the whiskey. Hurry up, hide the whiskey. Before you open that door.
Shall we put it in the book?
That's the first place he looked.
Shall we put it behind the door?
No, he found it there before.
Put it here, put it there.
Oh, man, put it anywhere, but hide the whiskey. That's go ahead, hide the whiskey. Before you open that door. Oh, hello, Rev. Would you like to have a Pepsi Cola?
Minstrelsy, black minstrelsy, was actually white people blackening up to imitate black people, making a caricature out of them as they saw them on the plantation, not knowing that for a form of entertainment, black people were mimicking white people. White people were able to receive a career imitating blacks, and also not allowing blacks to be on stage. And then after the Civil War, there was the opportunity for blacks, some blacks, to be able to perform on stage. And they, as black people, having to blacken up to imitate white people who were blackening up to imitate black people. How crazy. How crazy.
Oh, the boll weevil lamb, a little black bug, come from Mexico, they say. Come all the way to Texas, just a-looking for a place to stay. Just a-looking for a home, just a-looking for a home. Now, the first time I see the boll weevil, he was sitting on the square. The next time I see the boll weevil, he had all his family there. Just a-looking for a home, just a-looking for a home.
Now the farmer taken the boll weevil, and he put him in the hot sand. The weevil said, "This is mighty hot, but I'll stand it like a man. This'll be my home, it'll be my home." Now the farmer takes this boll weevil, and puts him in a lump of ice. The boll weevil said to the farmer, "This is mighty cool and nice. It'll be my home, this'll be my home."
The farmer say to the weevil, "What make your head so red?" The weevil say to the farmer,
"It's a wonder I did, looking for home.
Looking for home,
just looking for home."
Now the merchant got half the cotton, the boll weevil got the rest.
He did.
Didn't leave the farmer's wife but one old cotton dress, and it's full of home. It's a full of home.
Now the farmer said to the merchant, "We is in an awful fix. The boll weevil ate up all the cotton and left us only a stick. We got no home.
Got no home.
We got no home."
Now the captain said to the missus, "What do you think of that? The boll weevil done made a nest in my best Sunday hat. Wanna have a home? Wanna have a home?"
Now if anybody should ask you who it was that made this song, Just tell them 'twas a dark-complected fella with a pair of blue duckies on. Ain't got no home.
Got no home.
Ain't got no home.
Now the boll weevil say to the farmer, you better leave me alone. I done it all your cotton and now I gonna start on your corn.
Minstrelsy, black minstrelsy was actually white people blackening up to imitate black people, making a caricature out of them as they saw them on the plantation, not knowing that for a form of entertainment, black people were mimicking white people. White people were able to receive a career imitating blacks and also not allowing blacks to be on stage. And then after the Civil War, there was the opportunity for blacks, some blacks, to be able to perform on stage. And they, as black people, having to blacken up to imitate white people who were blackening up to imitate black people. How crazy. How
crazy. I'm Eric Hodge. This is WUNC Music's Songs We Love podcast. All this year, we're asking people in the music community to pick a song they love that says something about our home state. It's part of our Come Here and See series. This state is home to some pioneers in American music. There's Earl Scruggs, Roberta Flack, and Thelonious Monk. One early innovator many overlook is Pigmeat Markham. He was a comedian and performer who toured widely, played the famed Apollo Theater, and later broke through on television.
I was reading in the paper, at least a friend of mine read it to me, rather. Where you want a boy to work? I come down to see if I get that job. Well, I did advertise.
Dewey Pigmeat Markham was born in 1904 in Durham's Hayti community. He's said to have left home at the age of 13 to sing and dance as part of a traveling burlesque show. He was African-American, but was still frequently asked to perform in blackface. He appeared with Milton Berle, Bessie Smith, and Eddie Cantor, and by the 1950s, was one of this country's most popular African-American performers. As a comedian, he made people laugh. As a musician, he made them dance.
The coat of swing is just about ready to do that thing. I don't want no tears, I don't want no lies. Above all, I don't want no alibis. This judge is hip, and that ain't all. He'll give you time if you're big or small. Fall in line, or this coat is neat. Peace, brother.
Whoa, here come the judge. Here come the judge. Everybody know that he is the judge.
This song, Here Comes the Judge, is often cited as the first hip-hop song.
As a hip-hop artist and hip-hop historian who's kind of looked into the roots of the genre and the culture, I was really surprised to learn that one of the pioneers was from my hometown in Durham.
That's Pierce Freelon. He's a musician, activist, and scholar from Durham.
I think Pigmeat Markham is one of these guys that is just below the surface, but he was certainly just a very influential figure. You can tell by listening to his music. And so, I think that's one of our jobs is to raise up and to lift and celebrate our ancestors so that they aren't forgotten.
Here Comes the Judge was a hit for Pigmeat Markham in 1968 and made it up to number 4 on the R&B charts. The song and comedic routine got a boost when Sammy Davis Jr. did it as a recurring bit on the TV show Laugh-In'.
Your Honor, I'm pleading innocent to this burglary rap.
Well, I think I got you because you forgot about one important visual defect in your case.
What's a visual defect?
Somebody saw you doing it.
But it's the song that still gets Pierce Freelon.
At the beginning of the song, there are these like funk drums. And then his flow, it's just straight out of the jaw of Run DMC and Sugar Hill Gang.
I guess by now you can take a hunch and find that I am the baby of the bunch. But that's
I don't want no tears, I don't want no lies. Above all, I don't want no alibis.
You know, the call and response, the humor, you know, it's a funny song.
Who's there?
Eyes.
Eyes who?
Eyes your next door neighbor.
Pig Meat Markham was a comedian at heart. He liked to make people laugh and, like many doing burlesque, was comfortable going for the quick laugh. There's a lot of that in this song.
Out of this courtroom! Out of this courtroom!
Judge, your honorship high, sir. Did I hear you say order in the court?
Yes, I said order.
Well, I'll take two cans of beer, please.
But when the verse comes back around, Pig Meat Markham slips seamlessly into a sharp critique of the war in Vietnam.
I had a chat with Ho Chi Minh, sipped rice wine and chased with gin. Won't take long, that's a miss, my guess. I have you out of this doggone mess.
You know, and this is political discourse that at the time may have been very difficult to have, to talk about, you know, anti-war sentiments. And, you know, he had contemporaries like Marvin Gaye who really had to struggle to get protest songs out. But when you put it in this context of a comedic routine, you can kind of touch on some other political issues. And you saw Richard Pryor and Red Fox. You know, the comedy is sometimes the one of the only spaces where we can be really political without suffering, you know, the social consequences of bringing up these touchy subjects.
I set up cable to Bobby Mack. Let them know I'm coming back. Sit right down with Rockin' Nicks. Teach them both some pig meat tricks.
Judge, you're on a pig meat, sir. Don't you remember me?
No, who are you, boy?
Well, I'm the fella that introduced you to your wife.
To my wife?
Yeah.
Life, you son of a gun, you.
This single came out in 1968 on Chess Records. Pierce Freelon sees it as one of the precursors for contemporary hip-hop. Pig Meat Markham's sound and aesthetic paved the way for artists like Run DMC and Boogie Down Productions. Joseph Sadler, better known as Grandmaster Flash, was 10 when this song was a radio hit.
It shows that hip-hop came from a legacy. It didn't just burst out of nowhere. There was, you know, James Brown and Muhammad Ali and Oscar Brown Jr. and Pig Meat Markham that were all doing things that I think nowadays we would describe as a precursor, but at the time was just kind of an innovative way of infusing kind of lyrics and rhythm and, you know, the beats. And, you know, that would coalesce with The Last Poets and Grandmaster Flash and Afrika Bambaataa as what we know today as hip-hop.
Election time, you vote your way and I vote mine. Cases are tied and the money gets spent. Vote for Pig Meat Markham, President.
Hip-hop, you know, is a great genre for storytelling, and Pig Meat Markham was a great storyteller.
I am the judge, I am the judge. Everybody knows
that. Pierce Freelon says he's proud that Durham can claim Pig Meat Markham is one of its own. He's part of a long line of artists from Durham that includes Shirley Caesar, the Sensational Nightingales, and more recently, Ninth Wonder and Little Brother.
You know, I think Durham plays a really important historic role in black culture in this country with Black Wall Street. And, you know, he came from the Haiti community, and it speaks to the wonderful soil that we have here in North Carolina, specifically in Durham, just fertile ground for the black imagination to roam wild and to be innovative.
I am the judge. Everybody knows that I am the judge. I am the judge. I am the judge.
Everybody knows that he is the judge.
Now, everybody know I am the judge.
Here Comes the Judge by Durham's own Pig Meat Markham is one of the songs we love at WUNC Music.
Yeah, he, this court is now in session. His Honor, Judge Pig Meat Markham presiding. Yeah, he, the coat of swing is just about ready to do that thing. I don't want no tears, I don't want no lies. Above all, I don't want no alibis. This judge is hip, and that ain't all. He'll give you time if you're big or small. Fall in line, or this coat is neat.
peace, brother.
Whoa, here come the judge. Here come the judge. Everybody know that he is the judge.
Everybody, near and far, I'm going to Paris to stop this war. All those cats got to listen to me, because I am the judge that you can plainly see. I want a big round table when I get there. I won't sit down to wonder square. I'm gonna lay down the law. They better not budge. I bust some head because I am the judge.
He is the judge. He is the judge. Everybody knows that he is the judge.
Who's there?
Eyes.
Eyes who?
Eyes your next door neighbor. Out of this courtroom.
Judge, your honorship high, sir. Did I hear you say order in the court?
Yes, I said order.
Well, I'll take two cans of beer, please.
I had a chat with Ho Chi Minh. Sip rice wine and chase him with gin. Won't take long, unless I miss my guess. I have you out of this doggone mess.
Judge, you're on a pig meat, sir. Don't you remember me?
No, who are you, boy?
Well, I'm the fella that introduced you to your wife.
To my wife?
Yeah.
Life, you son of a gun, you. Come November election time, you vote your way and I vote mine. Case is a tie and the money gets spent. Vote for pig meat, not for president. I am the judge. I am the judge. Everybody knows that. Now, everybody know I am the judge.
Minstrelsy, black minstrelsy, was actually white people blackening up to imitate black people, making a caricature out of them as they saw them on the plantation, not knowing that for a form of entertainment, black people were mimicking white people. White people were able to receive a career imitating blacks and also not allowing blacks to be on stage. And then after the Civil War, there was the opportunity for blacks, some blacks, to be able to perform on stage. And they, as black people, having to blacken up to imitate white people, who were blacking me up to imitate black people. How crazy.
Stubborn, argumentative, and sarcastic. Not exactly the kind of endearing qualities that create a connection between a television character and audiences. But that's precisely why millions tuned into a fictional inner-city junk man. Today is part of NPR's series In Character, a look at the fictional American characters that have had an impact on our lives. We take a closer look at Fred Sanford. A warning to our listeners, we'll be hearing clips from the show that contain language that includes racial epithets.
It was the winter of 1972 when Sanford and Son was introduced to America's primetime TV audience on NBC.
Oh, is this the Ace Plumbing Company? Yeah, well, this is Fred Sanford. Sanford, S-A-N-F-O-R-D, period speaking.
Comedian Red Fox was cast by producers Norman Lear and Bud Yorkin to play the gruff 65-year-old curmudgeon Fred Sanford. With his trademark suspenders, gravelly voice, and scraggly beard, Sanford lived in a Watts junkyard with his son Lamont, played by Demond Wilson. Fred's intimate and often emotional interaction with Lamont offered a slice of black family life rarely seen on network television at the time. Bud Yorkin.
The character between the son and the father was very interesting to me and to Norman, in the sense that despite the fact that they lived together and complained and so forth, what was interesting to me was the fact that they couldn't live without each other. And so that's what we based the idea on.
How would you like one across your lips?
The idea for the show was actually based on a British television comedy about two London junkmen called Steptoe and Son, but with one major difference. Both Fred and Lamont were black.
All right, now we got rid of the stuff and everything's been taken care of. You happy?
Happy. I got a truckload of copper at the bottom of the ocean. I'm out of 40 bucks and I'm sitting here with my dummy son. I didn't know a black man could be so happy.
That created challenges and opportunities for Fred and the rest of the show's cast to break new and sometimes controversial ground. Black audiences were crucial for the show's credibility, but white audiences had to embrace Fred Sanford if the show was to succeed.
You can't do a show that's dealing with Afro-Americans that the Afro-Americans don't like and don't want. And you don't want to do it so that it's just the Afro-Americans love it, but the other people don't want to see it. So you have to go in between.
Hey, Pops, how you feeling this morning?
Feel with my hand like I always did.
Fred Sanford's wit, down-home honesty, and sometimes acerbic comments were a hint of the actor who played him. Prior to his role on Sanford and Son, Red Fox was an established nightclub performer, famous for his adult humor.
Here was a guy who went to the doctor. He said, Doc, look at here. Doc said, you ever had that before? He said, uh-huh. Doc said, well, you got it again.
As Fred Sanford, he toned down his humor for television, but according to show writer Paul Mooney, he toned it down only so far.
Red Fox's character was too arrogant, too uppity. The things that he did and said, please, he could get lynched for less in Mississippi. Now, let's not try to be naive.
I'm driving along a street in Hollywood, see? All of a sudden, there's this woman standing out by the curb, messing around in the trash cans in front of a house.
White woman?
Yeah. Pop, this woman was about 90 years old.
Ain't nothing on earth uglier than a 90-year-old white woman.
It was written to be undignified.
Black television historian and author Fred McDonald says while Sanford and Son was groundbreaking, it was also dangerously reminiscent of the crude and unsophisticated African-American characters portrayed on the 1950s television show Amos and Andy. The difference, McDonald says, is that Fred Sanford successfully tiptoed the line between minstrelsy and mainstream comedy.
He was always, you know, attacking, slashing, a little bit out of control and scheming. So in that regards, you could put him in the line with the characters such as George Kingfish Stevens from Amos and Andy. But at the end, he was offset by the positive characters around him. And that balanced it.
Characters like Aunt Esther, Fred's Bible-toting sister-in-law played by LaWanda Page, who gave as good as she got.
Aha!
Where'd you come from?
Where you think I come from?
Under a rock.
You can't talk yourself out of this one, you two-timing beady-head weasel-eyed fool.
Like Norman Lear's seminal 1970s sitcom All in the Family, Sanford and Son also tackled taboo topics. In this clip, Fred takes on a prejudicial justice system with his distinct homespun philosophy and language.
Why don't you arrest some white drivers?
I do.
You do? Well, where are they? Look at all these niggas in here. There's enough niggas in here to make a Tarzan movie.
Sanford and Son producer Bud Yorkin remembers Red Fox campaigning to use the N-word in that episode.
He said, let me do that stuff. I want to be able to say that. And I said, I don't feel comfortable with it, but if you feel I can do it, you can't do it. I don't want somebody else doing it, but I can do it. So I said, well, okay, Red, And he did it. And by and large, we never got any complaints.
Indeed. The show's blend of comedy and controversy lasted for 135 episodes over 6 seasons. For 5 of those seasons, Sanford and Son was among the country's top 10 rated television shows.
You know what I've decided to do? I'm going to do missionary work. Probably be going to Africa. I'll be doing work among your people.
Not mine. My people in St. Louis.
Today, Fred Sanford is still wobbling around his junkyard on arthritic knees via syndication 36 years after his network debut. But what draws younger viewers and old fans to the little junkyard in Watts week after week? The junk man who ran it, says Bud Yorkin.
You felt more for him than you did for his son, because after all, the son was young, and you didn't want to hear him complain to the father, and you ruined it. I had a date tonight, and you bring in three guys that want to sit down and play poker with you. And why, how can you do that to me, Dad? And we get into a whole scene. Well, you feel sorry for the father more than you do for the son. But there was no doubt that they loved that character.
Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the best-dressed man of all? Give me my answer and make me contented. Make it quick, because this suit is rented.
Tony Cox, NPR News.
Red Fox, Red Fox, Red Fox.
Records presents the very fabulous Leroy, Skillet, and LaWanda. I'm slack-jawed Leroy from 42nd Street.
I hear you.
I got money in my pocket and a big hunk of meat.
I like the men folk. I'm LaWanda Big Bottom. If you're looking for thrills, mother, I got them.
Harlem's my playground, just like a boy's camp. I dug you, baby, when you was leaning against that lamp.
I checked you out, Daddy, when you was shuffling up the road. I knew right then I was more woman than you could afford.
You a fine-looking chick. I think I'll take a chance. That's a whole lot of packed in those pants.
Just look at you, fool, juicing at the lips. If you knew what I had, baby, you turned back over flip.
Mama, you're looking good, soft, round, and nice. To know something that cool must have a big price.
Now, I see how you talk. Man, you a real dope. If you want to live high on a hog, baby, you got to ask the price of pork.
Wow, those dicks is enough to knock a man down. With nipples like grapes in my favorite shade of brown.
Now don't be bashful, baby. I'll speak first. You can buy me a beer to help quench my thirst.
I'll buy you a beer to help break the ice. Get your drunk and probably cut Rachel Price.
Now if you like what you see and you like to poet, baby, just reach in your pocket and pull out your damn wallet.
He was known as Dolomite and Willie Green. I'm talking about the rhyming comedian Rudy Ray Moore. Moore died over the weekend after a long battle with illness. He was 81 years old. He cut countless blue comedy records beginning in 1959. He also made several cult films during the blaxploitation era. Here to help us put Moore's career in perspective is Todd Boyd. He's a professor of critical studies at the University of Southern California's School of Cinematic Arts. Hi, Todd.
Hi.
So, to give us a taste of Rudy Ray Moore, let's listen to a trailer from his first film, the self-produced Dolomite, circa 1974.
Dolomite is my name, and f***ing up mother is my game. I've got an all-girl army that knows what to do. They'll box as hell and practice kung fu. I put my finger in the ground and turn the whole world around. Yes, I'm Dolomite. I'm the one that killed Monday and whooped Tuesday and put Wednesday in the hospital. Called up Thursday to tell Friday not to bury Saturday on Sunday. I'm the one that had the elephants roosting in trees and all the ants wearing BBD. From the first to the last, I give them the blast so fast that their life is past before their ass has even hit the grass. See me uptown, downtown, crowned and renowned. Delayed, relayed, mislaid, and parlayed. Hatch, match, snatch, and scratch. Whack, jack, smack, crack, boot black, blackjack, racetrack, and flapjack, and still coming back. If you crave satisfaction, this is the place to find that action. Coming to this theater as this next attraction is the picture that will put you in traction. Dolomite.
Okay, Todd, that's a lot of information to process, and it's dated, you know. What is it saying, or where is it in the history of kind of popular black cinema? What are we supposed to make out of this?
Well, the importance of a figure like Rudy Ray Moore and the Dolomite character comes from the fact that it represented what some might refer to as the Chitlin' Circuit of, say, black popular culture from another era, a time when there were still elements of black culture that were only, you know, performed for black audiences, a time before, you know, the time we live in now where elements of black culture are pretty pervasive across the landscape and are very accessible in the mainstream. In Rudy Ray Moore's time and his era, that was just starting to happen. But Rudy Ray Moore was someone who had a loyal black fan base who spoke to his audiences about issues that would be funny to them and in a manner and in a language that was very familiar. But I think that element of black culture, what some might call black folk culture, has probably passed at this point, but his significance lies in the fact that he, in many ways, transcended that moment because he was, of course, later referenced many, many times as hip-hop culture became so prominent.
Tell us about some of those references. I mean, you know, you can definitely listen to Snoop and hear him reference Dolomite. Why would hip-hop artists reference this character?
Well, again, you know, Dolomite is a figure from a era of black popular culture that was, at least in his case, segregated. And so if you were a young black male growing up in the, you know, 60s and 70s, learning the Dolomite routines was like a rite of passage. And so for a generation of rappers coming of age in the 80s, they would have listened to Dolomite. They would have been exposed to Dolomite. And you have, you know, people like Too Short, what he calls his favorite word, this exaggerated pronunciation of the word that people would be very familiar with if they know Too Short, actually grows from Rudy Ray Moore. You could talk about Big Daddy Kane versus Dolemite on a Big Daddy Kane record, Taste of Chocolate, in which the two of them sort of went at each other in this verbal joust reminiscent of the cutting sessions that defined the black oral tradition. So as hip-hop started to come of age, you have other examples like Dr. Dre on The Chronic, for instance. He uses a sample of Dolemite's joke, "If I Had Some Nuts Hanging on the Wall." So, you know, if you knew that culture, if you learned it as a rite of passage, and then later on started to come of age as hip-hop became popular, to use Dolemite was to indicate your connection to that older era, but at the same time make him relevant in a more contemporary environment.
His contemporaries included people like Red Fox and Richard Pryor. Why do you think he wasn't more popular in the mainstream?
Well, you know, Red Fox and his stand-up comedy was actually part of a similar circuit as that of Dolemite. But at a certain point, Red Fox transcended that and, of course, became quite popular on Sanford and Son. But if you look at Red Fox on Sanford and Son and you listen to his stand-up routines, they're two different things. Richard Pryor, you know, the greatest American comedian ever, if you know his career, he started out as someone imitating Bill Cosby in the early 60s, and it wasn't until the late 60s that he evolved. He hooked up with Huey Newton and the Black Panther Party, developed a great deal of consciousness, and that material, you know, came to define his presence in the 70s with his stand-up comedy. In the case of Rudy Ray Moore, it's folk culture. It's what some would call country. It's not necessarily something that's going to appeal to a broad audience, but would appeal to those who are familiar with those customs.
All right, Professor, thank you.
Thank you.
Todd Boyd is the Catherine and Frank Price Endowed Chair for the Study of Race and Popular Culture. He's also a professor of critical studies at the University of Southern California School of Cinematic Arts. And that's our show for today. Thank you for sharing your time with us. To listen to the show or subscribe to our podcast, visit our website, nprnewsandnotes.org.
Minstrelsy, black minstrelsy, was actually white people blackening up to imitate black people, making a caricature out of them as they saw them on the plantation, not knowing that for a form of entertainment, black people were mimicking white people. White people were able to receive a career imitating blacks and also not allowing blacks to be on stage. And then after the Civil War, there was the opportunity for blacks, some blacks, to be able to perform on stage. And they, as black people, having to blacken up to imitate white people who were blackening up to imitate black people. How crazy. How crazy.
Right, I'm bound to immediate shelter. This is not a drill.
Esto es una emergencia.
This station has interrupted its regular program at the request of the during this emergency, most
we are sick and tired of being sick and tired.
Today is time to stop singing and stop swinging.
We are coming to get our check.
You are now listening to P-A-R, that's People Activity Radio, and I'm your host, Don G. Horse. Welcome, you have found your family in a peaceful place. P-A-R is a family-friendly information distribution program seeking to inform non-white people, in particular, black classifieds, and assisting in counter-racist codification.
Influence in Egypt, man. Let my people go.
The title of today's episode is Chitlin Circuit and Blue. Comedy Rhymes, the antecedents to United States rap cultures. One more time, the title of the day's episode is Chitlin Circuit and Blues. Comedy Rhymes, the antecedents to United States rap cultures. Let's get it in. We had a call on the energy from the great ancestor, Louis Armstrong. Holla at him.
Now listening to PAR, that's People Activity Radio, hosted by John G. Horse, a blue-collar commentary radio podcast attempting to remove confusion in everyday social events. If you are subject to non-white classification, in particular black classified, welcome, you have found your family in a peaceful place.
You have indeed found your family in a peaceful place. And once more time, let's run that thing back. Satchmo! Satchmo! Yes, indeed, this goes out to all the hard-working class, blue-collar people subject to non-white, in particular, black classification, getting it in, day out, 7 days a week, 5 days a week, however ever many days a week that you putting in that work, we're going to summon the energy from the late, great New Orleans jazz ancestor. To give a shout out to all the non-white people, in particular people subject to black classification, who dug into their purses, wallets, pocketbooks, satch bags, and what is in ever else you keep your resources in, all pennies, nickels, and dimes, and contributed to old John G's Cash App. To them, I want to give a black self-respect salute. Let's move on.
John G. Horse's Cash App is $J, O, H, N, capital G, capital H, O, R, S, E.
Where do we begin? Where do we begin is always the question. And this is PAR, People Activity Radio, and I am your gracious and humble host, John G. Horse, welcome. You have found your family in a peaceful place. And I will repeat the title of the day's episode. The title of the day's episode is Chitlin Circuit and Blue Comedy Rhymes, the antecedents to United States rap cultures. One more time, the title of today's episode is The Chitlin Circuit and Blue Comedy Rhymes, the antecedents to United States rap cultures. And if you are a frequent listener to PAR, you understand that the antecedents to United States rap cultures is a series that old John G holds near and dear to his heart, because old John G's pet peeve, old John G's problem sometimes with society, is we walk around in a constant, perpetual state of confusion. In some cases, we take honor in being extremely confused on all subjects and or all in all areas of people activity. And that is problematic if you want to live a constructive existence. and or participate in producing justice in this environment. That being said, what do you mean, John G. Horse? The Chitlin Circuit. What is the Chitlin Circuit? What is blue comedy? And we will address those two definitions within this show. But you know, old John G has to bring the receipts and has to bring context by laying the foundation from which he draws his titles and or subject matters from. And in this particular episode, Chitlin Circuit and Blue Comedy Rhymes, we are going to deal with what is the Chitlin Circuit, when was it created, and what is blue comedy, and why are you putting rhymes up in there? Now, one of the big misnomers here in the United States for non-white people is that we have been led to believe that what we know as rap today is something fairly new in the history of entertainment. And I argue, old John G argues, that rap and or spoken word and or performance poetry is not new. It is just as old as playing instruments in any discipline of entertainment globally and in this experiment that we know as the United States of America. So, old John G's position, before I get into the data portion of this episode, is that poetry, rap, as we call it today, spoken word, performance poetry, is essentially just as old as any other discipline that we find in entertainment. That's either true or it's not true. Let's move on. So the question would be, what is the foundation of entertainment culture here in the United States? What is the foundation of culture as we know in the United States? And one of the essential bricks and mortar that was planted into the culture of this experiment that we know as the United States was pop culture performed by minstrel performers. Now, if you don't know anything about minstrelsy, I would recommend that you Google minstrelsy. And it is nothing but a collection of entertainers in the United States in the late 1700s and early 1800s who decided to go on these traveling entertainment voyages that we know as minstrelsy troupes. And what you would have is a lot of music, a lot of dance, a lot of slapstick comedy and comedy bits that did not originate in the United States, but they were modified to fit the United States culture. Now, what do you mean to fit the United States culture? Well, one of the essential things from the foundation of this country was anti-blackness, meaning everything. It doesn't matter what discipline, it doesn't matter what section of people activity you find yourself in, you will find bricks and cement of systematic anti-blackness welded all up in it. Now, that's either true or it's not true. And in the case of the entertainment industry or pop culture as we know it, blackface minstrelsy is a founding brick laid down to cement how entertainment was going to be performed in these United States in the foundation of this country. Now, we do know this country was founded off of enslavement of non-white people, in particular people subject to black classification, and under that context is how we arrive at blackface minstrelsy. Now, if you were a minstrel performer, performing artist, and in most cases in the late 1700s and early 1800s, most of those minstrelsy troupe performers were immigrants from European nations who wanted to get a foothold in some discipline, and one of the wide open terrains that had a little wiggle room for white immigrants to come in was that entertainment terrain, because you had a lot of European
entertainment, but it would be isolated to certain groups. So you would have Irish entertainment, you would have German entertainment, you would have Danish entertainment, you would have Spanish entertainment, you would have all these disciplines that came from European nations, Portuguese entertainment, you would have all these disciplines, but it wasn't something that would be consumed by the masses. It would be consumed by that particular group. So you would be limited in the sections of the United States that you could go to make money. If you're going into a Irish settlement and you're doing some Portuguese entertainment, ain't nobody want to come see that mess. If you are performing in a German settlement and you're doing Irish performances and slapstick comedy and variety shows, don't nobody want to see that. They want to see things that they generally have a common interest in. Are you following me? So some of the geniuses, for the lack of a better term, people who classify themselves as white, they were performing these minstrelsy shows. Once they started to navigate themselves through the colonies of the United States, they found that there was this common denominator, no matter if you was in the North or if you was in the South, and it was mistreatment of people subject to black classification and or prisoners of war who would find themselves on these terror squad plantations working free of charge and or being subject to enslavement in these United States. And what they would find is non-white people subject to black classification on the plantation would perform variety shows for their owners. And these shows would be non-white people subject to black classification pretending to be white. And they would mock and make fun of their slave owners, family, and or masters and mistresses. And perform these over-accentuated comedy bits pretending to be white people, which wasn't accurate portrayals of white people and or black people, but this was something that was cultivated in prison culture that we know as plantation culture. And when you are a variety performance and you're looking at these extravagant, talented, skillful performances by non-white people, the first thing you're going to do is pretend or take some of that material and implement it into your performances. And some of these immigrants who were in these minstrelsy troupes went so far as to paint themselves black. Now, this is no different than Greek philosophy being really ancient Cometan or ancient Egyptian philosophy. And if you are under that understanding that everything you get from the Greek philosophers actually came from ancient Egypt that is found in Africa, you can kind of see the pattern of people who classify themselves as white. They always look to non-white people classified as black, and they take from our creative genius. It's nothing new about this. This has been being done for hundreds of years, and blackface minstrelsy is no different. So blackface minstrelsy is a product of plantation black people being enslaved prisoners of war. It is a product of that environment. It is a product of that toxic, unbalanced, incorrect environment. This is toxic culture. Now, once the white immigrants got a hold of these dances and routines and these dialects, they then put their white seasoning on it. And they were extremely successful in changing up their routines, painting themselves black, and acting black, for the lack of a better term. Now, what is acting black? It depends on who's doing it. Because people subject to Black Classification Act black,
people subject to non-white classification would act black, and the most successful black actors were men and women who classified themselves as white acting black. They actually certified what acting black really was, meaning the success of these minstrelsy troupes. Are you following me? This is extremely deep, family. This is extremely deep, because everything that we think is our culture actually derives from anti-culture being performed by people who classify themselves as white who were not part of the culture, yet they were the gatekeepers of these behaviors that came out of the toxic plantation environment. I hope I haven't confused you yet. Let's move on. So now, if you a person subject to non-white, in particular black classification, and you wanted to get into the entertainment industry, by the time you got to the 1830s, 1840s, 1850s, you had no other choice but to practice your entertainment ambitions through the vessel or vehicle or cookie cutter model of the minstrel tradition. Craziness now, fellow black classifieds. So now you are a person subject to black classification. You want to get into the entertainment business. You have a talent. You have ambition. You can't create something which fits your stomach or that you can tolerate. You have to then go through the vessel, the vehicle of minstrelsy, because that was the only show in town. No, nobody know nothing about nothing unless you're doing a minstrel show and or performance. So you would take these European routines, and you would take the absurd mannerisms, dialects, Negro dialects, the dress, and even people who were ambitious and wanted to be performers and they were subject to black classification, they went as far as painting themselves black. Just to make a penny, nickel, or dime in the entertainment industry in this toxic environment of non-justice. In the toxic environment of non-justice that old John G is referring to is the toxic environment of racism, white supremacy, white terror, domination, and or systematic anti-blackness. Now, during this time, it is extremely dangerous to be in a traveling troupe if you were subject to black classification, because if you went across the wrong county line, you might wind up captured, re-enslaved, or enslaved, and or taken off the planet. Now, this is either true or it's not true. 1830s, 1840s, 1850s, 1860s, and something changed. Something changed in the 1860s, and that was the Civil War. Work was being put in by people subject to non-white classification, in particular people classified as black. And after the Civil War, it was more acceptable for people subject to black classification to actually form legitimate minstrel troops. Now, when I say minstrel troops, everybody's going to ask, why in the world would somebody classified as black want to be part of minstrelsy? What no other entertainment model, fellow black classifieds? That was it. If you was going to be in entertainment, you was going to be doing these variety shows. Are you following me? I don't think that we understand this. 1865, 1866, 1867, 1870s, 1880s, there were black minstrelsy troops owned and created by people subject to black classification with the same traditions that have been embedded and or sold into the United States cultural lexicon.
Most of these people grew up off this thing, off this toxic entertainment that we know as minstrelsy. Now, minstrelsy became very competitive because now you have people subject to black classification saying, oh, you don't want to go watch them white folks pretending to be black. You want to watch black folks pretending to be white folks pretending to be black. And we're going to authenticate our performances by calling ourselves the real coons, the real porch monkeys, the real niggers, for the lack of a better term. Now, does this sound familiar, fellow black classifieds? Does this ring a bell for contemporary times? We gonna get there. Let's move on. So now you got people subject to black classification almost dominating the black minstrelsy circuit because the songs were better, the dance were better, the routines were a little bit more authentic, the language and the Negro dialect had a little bit more flavor to it, you know, rhythm, seasoning, marinated and all that soul. You know how we do when we put our foot into something, fellow black classifiers. So people who actually created the genre of minstrelsy, who had a monopoly over the genre of minstrelsy, had to reaffirm their dominance. So then they, around the 1870s, 1880s, created the vaudeville entertainment circuit. So now we ain't got to do all that traveling. We're just going to perform in well-known auditoriums, well-known theaters, and we're going to put some certification on it where this is known as high-class entertainment. But still, they still had to blackface. They still had to slapstick comedy. They still had the top hat, black court, big lips, and the coon routines in vaudeville. They only exiled those people who were classified as black. So if you wanted to make real money, big time money, and not have to worry about all of the hazards of the traveling troupe life, you wanted to be insured. You wanted guaranteed pay from check to check. You wanted benefits. You wanted exposure to the mainstream entertainment industry. You had to go through the vehicle of vaudeville. So the people who created blackface minstrelsy abandoned the vehicle of blackface minstrelsy and the traveling troupe model, and they recreated a union of halls and theaters that would have vaudeville performance. Now, vaudeville is the precursor to what we know now as Hollywood, because vaudeville morphed into the Hollywood industry because the white entertainers from vaudeville simply started to perform in motion picture. Before motion picture and recording and all of that, there was vaudeville. Once motion picture and sound came in, the vaudeville entertainment, who were exclusively classified as white, then became Hollywood entertainers. Now, there was something very interesting about vaudeville, and I'm going to discuss that. Vaudeville did exile black entertainments, but from time to time, because vaudeville was a competitive industry amongst vaudeville groups and or vaudeville troupes, different white owners and creators of different white troupes, some white owners and creators of vaudeville entertainment troupes would recruit top talent from what we know as blackface minstrelsy troops. Now, they were blackface minstrelsy troops, but they were exclusive entertainment troops that primarily performed for black people. Now, blackface minstrelsy, then, when it was exclusive to people subject to black classification, developed a different form of blackface minstrelsy, still drenched in the tradition of anti-blackness, yet able to evolve
into something different than what it was when it initially was created by white immigrants. And this is what we call the chitlin circuit, because you had what was the black vaudeville circuit, which was nothing but a recruiting ground for the mainstream, more inferior circuit, but it was advertised as a superior form of entertainment, which was vaudeville. Vaudeville was white folks. Black vaudeville was non-white people subject to black classification. And if I can flip through my notes, hold on, family, let me get that term that was known as black vaudeville and or as we know it today as the chitlin circuit. One second, fellow black classifieds. I found the information as far as the black vaudeville official association was called the Theaters Owners Booking Association, which was created by Sherman H. Dudley. And that is the Owners Booking Association created by vaudeville performer Sherman H. Dudley. And he was indeed classified as black. And they called it the TOBA, Theater Owners Booking Association. And those people subject to black classification that actually got booked on the TOBA, Theater Owners Booking Association, also used that as being tough on black asses. That's what they called it. Meaning that Theater Owners Booking Association was very tough. It was the chitlin circuit. Man, you found yourself in all types of holes in the walls. It wasn't the immaculate theaters that the white performers were performing in. And let's be honest, if you were performing in the TOBA, the Theaters Owners Booking Association, which is the chitlin circuit, your aspirations was to be recruited, plucked out of the TOBA, plucked out of the chitlin circuit, and plucked and given work in vaudeville, where white folks was. This is the facts, and is no different to today. Yeah, we're gonna say, wow, why didn't they take pride in what they were doing? Why didn't they take ownership and make what they were doing immaculate like vaudeville, because it was superior entertainment? Well, the truth of the matter is, you have to acknowledge the environment that you are in. You are in a toxic environment of anti-blackness. Don't you think they did do that? And most likely at every corner, they probably were thwarted by the very people who dominated or monopolized vaudeville. You understand me? Now, you can have your little chitlin circuit, but you're not going to be booking at these big-time theaters taking all our money. Then we're going to cease to exist. The system of racism and white supremacy is a system of non-competition. It's a system of guaranteeing dominance for those people who find themselves, or for those people who are subject or who classify themselves as white. Sorry, I'm getting a little tongue-tied because I'm very passionate about this subject. I apologize in advance. Now, that being said, yes, the best cream of the crop talent was recruited out of the TOBA. Who was the best cream of the crop talent? Now, I know I'm gonna hurt a little feelings. Step and Fetch It, Leak and Perry were some of the best cream of the crop talent. Bill Bojangles Robinson was some of the best cream of the crop talent. Sammy Davis Jr. was some of the best cream of the crop talent out of the chilling circuit. Are you following me? Hattie McDaniel was some of the best cream of the crop talent out of the chitlin circuit. Are you following me? Moms Mabley was some of the best cream of the crop talent out of the chitlin circuit and or the TOBA. Now, these are the people who gets ridiculed and criticized, but when they did make it to the big time, they get criticized as if they were the producers and distributors and manufacturers of film, radio, and television. They were employees who came from out of the smut, the dirt. Do you not understand? The TOBA, the chitlin circuit, was extremely hazardous to your health. You go into the southern region of the United States, if you don't understand the codes of the cities that you're in, you might wind up lynched. And Mobs Mabley would speak on this all the time. And I believe Mom Mabley, I think she passed away in the 1970s, but she is known as the first mainstream female comedian who was successful. She just happened to be subject to black classification, but that's neither here nor there. Do we understand that Moms Mabley, grew up watching the minstrel tradition? Moms Mabley came up out of the Chitlin' Circuit? We're going to talk about Moms maybe a little bit later in the episode, but I just needed to establish the foundation from which I am coming from. You understand me? Because when we're looking at entertainment, when we're looking at music industry, when we're looking at the film industry, when we're looking at the television industry, it is the children of the first version of entertainment culture in the United States that we know as blackface minstrelsy. Now, we'll talk crazy to Tyler Perry for putting on the skirt and performing a linchpin caricature that is found in minstrelsy. We'll talk crazy to him, but we will never address the root cause of all this toxicity in our environment. And that is what we here on People Activity Radio aim to produce: codification, counter-racist codification, understanding the environment that we're in, understanding that this system is drenched in all areas of people activity, no matter where you are on this globe. Can't even go watch a movie. You're getting beat down, by fundamental racism, white supremacy. Now, that's either true or it's not true. Let's get back to the Toba. Let's get back to the Chitlin' Circuit. Now, understanding that once Hollywood got popping, all and once the radio industry got popping, all of the bricks have been laid down of anti-blackness, and everything from television, radio, and film had anti-blackness sewed into its layers. It is what it is. How are you going to grow as an entertainer? Let's say that you're, what's our brother's name? Richard Pryor. Let's say you're Rudy Ray Moore, Dolemite. Let's say you're Bill Cosby. Let's say you're Whoopi Goldberg. Whoopi Goldberg became famous when she popularized a one-woman show, and she was just acting like Moms Mabley. Her words, not mine. Moms Mabley is a child born in 1904 who grew up off of fundamental blackface minstrelsy. Now, that's either true or it's not true. And she's one of the founding women in the entertainment industry discipline of comedy. Moms Mabley. Red Fox. Let's get into the work, fam. Let's get into the work, because, you know, I'm getting my voice. You know how I get. And I'm trying not to hoop and holler each episode. I'm a work in progress. Please bear with me. Let's move on. So now let's get to the topic. And the title of today's the topic is, one more time, because old John G went on one of his tangents, Chitlin' Circuit and Blue Comedy Rhymes, the antecedents to United States rap culture. Now, why are you talking about the antecedents to United States rap culture, old John G? You don't like hip-hop music? I ain't got no problem with no hip-hop music. But unfortunately, old John G's not from the region that created what we know as the rhyme culture and or the rhyme discipline of hip-hop, which has a lot of rap all up in it. Now, I am a fan of rap, and I can respect anybody who can put words together, be it simple or complex rhymes, metaphors, soliloquies, punchlines, whatever you want to call it. I love the art of creation of words and painting a picture with the dialect. I don't care where you're from, but I most value rhyme and poetry that I can identify with. And unfortunately, old John G is from the southern region of the United States, and I identify
with Southern topic field rhymes. It's not a crime. No more a crime than if someone is from the five boroughs of the United States. They actually value those rhymes because they can identify with the images and pictures that are being created from those artists that comes from out of that environment. Now that's either true or it's not true. Let's move on. So the first clip was old John G's intro, and then the following clip was a clip and or a documentary which was moderated by Dr. Louis Childe Soki. Now, I hope I'm not pronouncing the brother's name wrong, but he is the author of the book, The Last Darkie. He was accompanied by Dr. Camille F. Forbes, and I believe she is a professor at the University of California, San Diego, and she is an author of the book called Introducing Burt Williams and professor of theater arts at Morgan State University. Was our sister Shirley Basefield Dunlap. And they all were commenting off of the toxic environment of vaudeville and our fellow black classified ancestor, Burt Williams. Now, I always play portions for Burt Williams because Burt Williams was being recorded in the late 1800s. He was being recorded in the early 1900s. I believe one of the hits that I play all the time on People Activity Radio is one of his hits that was recorded in 1906. Nobody, where Burt Williams is performing in Negro dialect and he is rapping. He's not singing over the jazz ragtime beat. He is rapping. The antecedents to United States rap culture did not start in no five boroughs of New York City. It has always been here. It was just essential to people subject to black classification. It was just part of our culture from the beginning of whenever the beginning was. The time before time, as the Aboriginals would call it in Australia. Let's move on. So, the following clip after those professors were talking about the entertainment giant of Burt Williams was Butterfly McQueen. Butterfly McQueen is known for her part that she played in Gone with the Wind. I believe her character's name was Prissy. Now, you can go do your research on that. I'm not going to recommend that movie, but if you want to go do a little research on Gone with the Wind, go right ahead. Now, Prissy, I believe she was born in Tampa, Florida. I'm sorry, Butterfly McQueen. But I played a clip of Butterfly McQueen reciting the song Nobody, which was made famous by Burt Williams in 1906. Now, I believe Butterfly McQueen was performing this song in the late 70s or the 80s when she was running around trying to find work. But Butterfly McQueen clearly was on stage rapping. Butterfly McQueen is from the Toba. Butterfly McQueen is from the Chitlin Circuit. Butterfly McQueen was plucked out of the Chitlin Circuit by vaudeville, then given an opportunity with Hattie McDaniel, who also was from the Chitlin Circuit and vaudeville, and was given an opportunity to be on a film based upon the work and the legendary performances that they performed on the Chitlin Circuit, and they found themselves as Hollywood playing domestics. Caught a lot of criticism from playing to domestics, but what other choice did they have? Hollywood is the only show in town. Where they gonna take their talent to? But that's neither here nor there. This is not a story about Butterfly McQueen and the tragic legacy of acting black right now. This is simply historical documentation and giving resource material or source material on where you can find all this rapping before the late 1970s. Let's move on. Butterfly McQueen reciting Nobody. That was a clip of her. I believe she was performing that in the 1970s. Do your Googles. Let's move on. The next clip was of a comedy duo, a Chitlin Circuit legendary duo that was known as Butterbeans and Susie. And they were rapping. They were performing a routine, and they had many of these rap routines where they would go back and forth playing tag team with their bars. And the title of the song was called Elevator Papa and Switchboard Mama. And they had very complex metaphors and punchline rhymes in this rhyme. Now, again, I know people subject to black classification that are not from the five boroughs get charged with non-complex rap. And non-complex rap exists no matter where you find yourself on the globe. And complex metaphor-filled raps exist wherever you find yourself on the globe. Doesn't matter where you come from. It's just, you know, if you are a person who has a level of creativity and you like to go a little bit deeper with your rhymes, it's going to be a little bit more complex. Don't matter where you're from. You ain't got to be from the Bible Belt, the Black Belt. You ain't got to be from the five boroughs. You ain't got to be from the Midwest region. You ain't got to be from the West Coast region. There can be complex or non-complex rhymes, metaphor, poetry, where isn't ever you find yourself on the globe. Hell, you can be from New Zealand and you got a little creative skills with that word smithing, you're going to be able to put together whatever you gather from your spirit. You're following me? Again, we're gonna get into why old John G has this energy behind his commentary, but we got to get to the history and the foundation of this discipline that we call rap, and that is what we're doing right now. Let me lower down the hooping and hollering. So that was Butterbeans and Susie performing Switchboard Mama and Elevator Papa, Straight No Chaser, Bars. And I believe they've performed this in the 1930s. I could be in error. Let's move on. The following clip was an NPR interview of author and stand-up comedian known as D. Militant. And his real name is Daryl Littleton, and he is the author of the book called Black Comedians on Black Comedy, which was the inspiration behind the comedy documentary that was made called Why We Laugh. And D. Militant and or Daryl Littleton knows a lot, and he recites a lot about the historical evolution of comedy as it pertains to people classified as black. And I would recommend his book, Black Comedians on Black Comedy. And all, I would also recommend the documentary that he helped produce, which is called Why We Laugh. I believe you can find that Why We Laugh on YouTube, free of charge. And following that NPR interview, I played a clip of Moms Mabley. Godmother of comedy as it pertains to women. I played her rap song that she recorded in the 1960s called Hide the Whiskey. Straight No Chaser, Bars, comedy rap, blue comedy. They say blue comedy, I believe, because it has a little bit of foul language, lots of sexual innuendo, and it is very in line with under economy or unrespectable environments and behaviors from a certain section of our society. So, Moms Mabley, Hide the Whiskey, rap, Straight No Chaser, Bars, let's move on. I then played a song that was performed by Tex Ritter, who classifies himself as white, and fellow victim Mantan Moreland. Just like Moms Mabley, he was also from the Chitlin circuit. I believe Mantan Moreland was born like in 1902, 1904, something like that. So you know he came up when blackface minstrelsy was popping. And Mantan Moreland was one of these individuals who was ridiculed just like Lincoln, Steppin', Fetchit, Perry, because he played the fumbling, bumbling, no-count buffoon coon extremely well. But he honed those skills in the Toba, the
Chitlin Circuit, Black Vaudeville, and those skills he honed so well that Vaudeville, the white version which turned into Hollywood, recruited him. And when film and television was popping, Mantan Moreland was their guy. He got work. He got paid to perform a character. He was an employee. He wasn't the manufacturer and the creator of this toxic discipline that we know as anti-black pop culture, but he got treated as such toward the end of his life. And he was reciting a old minstrel song called The Bo Weevil, and this was on a show called Riders of the Frontier, white supremacist, suspected white supremacist variety show, kind of like Hee Haw. And he was performing with white performer, I believe he was a white country singer, something like that, Tex Ritter, who was singing in Negro dialect. And Mantan Moreland decided not to sing. He decided to recite the words of the song Bo Weevil, with words as if he was rapping. 1939, Riders of the Frontier, Tex Ritter, Mantan Moreland. Straight no chasers. Balls. Let's move on. The following clip was an expose by WUNC Radio. They were highlighting the contribution to hip hop culture of fellow Carolinian, I hope I'm saying that right, fellow North Carolina, native of North Carolina, Dewey Pig. Meat Markham. Dewey Pig Meat Martin, again, born in 1904, 1905, 1906. I forget the exact date. I apologize. It's always foggy when you're dealing with people subject to black classification, being born here in the United States of America. You know why? Because we are in a system which is anti-black, and I doubt that they had a efficient birth certificate system popping for people subject to black classification in the United States of America during the time of the early 1920s and 30s, but that's neither here nor there. The WUNC report was on Pigmeat Markham, born in North Carolina. And it was highlighting the song Here Comes the Judge. Here Comes the Judge was part of a routine that Pigmeat Markham performed in the Chitlin Circuit, in the TOBA, the Theater Owners Booking Association. Are you following me? Pigmeat Markham was a legend in the Chitlin Circuit, doing blue comedy. You following me? Doing blackface. He was one of the last entertainers to take off blackface. I mean, he was so emotionally attached to blackface. Lots of people who surrounded Pigmeat Markham say he went into a form of depression because he say it took a little bit out of his routine and his confidence in performing. He had been doing it so long. These people didn't know nothing outside of blackface minstrelsy. Blackface minstrelsy is all up in here. Now, I keep saying blackface minstrelsy is all up in here. Do you understand the people that we grew up watching? Eddie Murphy. Richard Pryor. You follow what I'm saying? Paul Mooney. Whoopi Goldberg. What's the sister's name? Oh, my gosh. I always forget her name. The great female comedian. She also did a one-woman show, and she performed a lot of the old Moms Mabley's routines. One second. Again, I'm getting a little bit long in the tooth and old in my age. Hold on. Let me shuffle through my notes. Miss Wanda Sykes. Oh, goodness gracious. I almost forgot. Yeah, it's Wanda Sykes. She did a one-woman show, again, paying homage to the originator, the architect, Moms Mabley. But Moms Mabley ain't no architect or nothing. If you talk to Moms Mabley, from her words, not mine, she got that from her grandma. 1800s. Moms Mabley was born in 1894, if I'm not mistaken. How old was her grandma? Moms Mabley says she was mimicking her grandmother. Are you following me? Now, we can argue that the tradition of a man dressing up in a dress, which was made famous on the minstrelsy circuit that we ridicule Tyler Perry from, Tyler Perry is an ambitious performance artist who clearly studied the discipline of comedy
in the United States of America, this toxic environment of the United States of America, had ambition, talent, creativity. You understand me? And he created the Madea caricature. Well, he didn't create the caricature. He just put his flavor, his seasoning, his marinade on the caricature. The caricature is just as old as the discipline of entertainment in the United States of America. Dating back to the 1600s. I could be in error. Do your own research. Out of that minstrelsy, anti-black pop culture known as minstrelsy, made tons of money for people, ambitious, talented entertainers, which come from the European Isles, the European nations. They wanted to get into the entertainment industry. The United States say, okay, you want to entertain, you better make fun of Negroes, or you ain't gonna make no money. And that is the same fundamental marching order that old John G sees in contemporary pop culture. If you're making fun of Negroes, you're gonna make some money. If you're mocking non-white people subject to black classification, you're gonna make some money. Now, as soon as you start to make jokes about people who classify themselves as white, gonna be some consequences, we're gonna shut you down. Now, that's either true or it's not true. Let's just use the example of the comedian Whoopi Goldberg versus the treatment of the comedian Joe Rogan. Now, I ain't finna go into no long dissertation about it. Just observe the treatment. Who's coming to Whoopi Goldberg's defense for misspeaking and or perceived mocking or belittling of the suffering of a certain group of people who classify themselves as white and practice Judaism? Because clearly we're not talking about the people who are subject to black classification who practice Judaism, because they getting mistreated over in the state of Israel. Now, that's either true or it's not true. They getting mistreated wherever they find themselves on the globe. Ain't nobody asking them what your religious faith is. You can be singing a song all you want to. I believe our ancestor, Sammy Davis Jr., was a Jewish practitioner. And he was catching mistreatment all over the nation and over the globe. Well-documented mistreatment. Now, that's either true or not true. You can do your research on Sammy Davis Jr. We're going to do a exclusive look into Sammy Davis Jr. Also, member, born in, talent that came out of the Chitlin' Circuit, plucked out by vaudeville. Creative, performing, artist, genius. Sammy Davis Jr., five-tool entertainer, sing, dance, act, drama, comedy, whatever you wanted to be done, Sammy could do at high levels. And when you was coming up out that Chitlin' Circuit, you had to do it all at high levels. And right now, we're talking about Pig Meek Markham, Chitlin' Circuit legend. Here come the judge. Here come the judge. Everybody know that he is the judge. 1968, Chitlin' Circuit legend, blue comedy genius, blackface minstrelsy performer. Pig Meek Markham, 1968, Straight No Chaser, bars. Following that was an NPR report speaking about the entertainment legacy of Sanford and Son star Red Fox, blue comedy performer, blues singer, rock and roll singer, rapper, comedian, Red Fox. And I played a rock rap song that he performed in the 1930s. Actually, he recorded this song in the 1930s. He had a lot of recordings. Red Fox was a blues musician. I can't make this stuff up now. And it was called Wiggle Little Woogie, 1930s, a rap rock bebop song by Red Fox. Rapping, 1930s. Ain't nobody made nothing up in no 1970s. This stuff has been in our culture from the time before time before time. Ain't nothing new.
That's either true or it's not true. And following the Red Fox report and song, I played his colleague. I think that LaWanda Page, who played Aunt Esther on Sanford and Son, she actually grew up in the same city as Red Fox. They actually went to high school together from my research. But I played a performance by LaWanda Page and Leroy Daniels, Leroy of Leroy and Skillet. Leroy and Skillet were the friends of Fran Sanford on the Sanford and Son show. Also, LaWanda Page was his sister-in-law, Aunt Esther. Are you following me? Fred Sanford seemed to have got all of his Chitlin Circuit colleagues and put them on the Sanford and Son show. I believe Stymie, the child actor Stymie, actually got a couple of episodes in. He was a friend of Fred Sanford. You have to think, blackface minstrelsy, anti-black pop culture. These individuals grew up in it. They were the people that we grew up watching watched as they grew up. We're all connected to this stuff. That's either true or it's not true. LaWanda Page, Leroy Daniels, they were rapping. They were doing a Chitlin Circuit blue comedy, explicit comedy, heavy sexual content, under economy content, juke joint, sugar shack. Are you following me? Honky tonk comedy for adults only. They called these party records, blue comedy records. LaWanda Page, Leroy Daniels, rapping. Are you following me? And following that, I had to put in an NPR report of Rudy Ray Moore, known as Leroy Green or Dolomite. I believe our great comedian Eddie Murphy just did a film on Rudy Ray Moore's life. 1968, Rudy Ray Moore, Rudy Ray Moore. Putting out them balls. Rudy Ray Moore, comedian. Rudy Ray Moore, blue comedy performance. Rudy Ray Moore, poet, performance artist. Rudy Ray Moore, film producer and film actor. Rudy Ray Moore comes out of the discipline of the Chitlin Circuit, out of the under economy explicit language, adults only, party records. Blue comedy. Dolomite. Are you following me? Rhyming in the 1960s. Are you following me? Ain't nothing start in no five boroughs of New York City. But New York City has its rap culture that they termed hip hop. Rap as we know it has always been in the entertainment culture of people subject to black classification in the United States of America. Rap is regional. Rap is poetry based upon the environment, a location that you find yourself in. Rap is intimate and exclusive to those who are rapping. That is why representation is always valued in rap, no matter if you're from Detroit, no matter if you're from Houston, no matter if you're from Los Angeles, the Bay Area, Sacramento, no matter if you're from Tennessee, no matter if you're from Chicago, Cleveland, no matter if you're New York, Philly, Miami, Tampa, Georgia, Atlanta, it doesn't matter. Mississippi got representation. Mississippi got poets. Mississippi got rappers. Mississippi got people who participated in the Chitlin Circuit industry. Everybody participated in this. It was exclusive to people subject to black classification. And people who were the cream of the crop got plucked out of the Chitlin Circuit talent pool. And those who did not get plucked out of the Chitlin Circuit talent pool, once television and film became larger than life, then those individuals started to get opportunity in mainstream entertainment. But don't get it twisted. We all are victim and were subject and still are subject to the toxic anti-black pop culture tradition of blackface minstrelsy. Then that's all dipped into rap. You either reacting off of understanding that, or you are illuminating the traditions of minstrelsy. It's either one or the other. And those who react to the anti-black pop culture, they call that conscious rap. Those who portray the images that were and the caricatures that were created in anti-black pop culture, it's just called rap, hip-hop, or whatever. And those people are generally the ones who make the most coins, pennies, nickels, and dimes, who don't acknowledge that this is toxic behavior. It's only one show in town. If you're ambitious and you want to manifest wealth, what you gonna
what
do?
What you gonna do?
Now that's either true, or it's not true. And I hope I have contributed to less confusion. And always remember, keep learning and stay codified.
Is all. And you're the prey.